Have you ever gone out to a restaurant with friends and when everybody's kind of getting their seat, there's that someone that you wanted to sit next to, that person that you were really hoping to talk with, and so they sit down over here, but it just works out that, you know, you can't sit and you have to, and you end up like way over on the other side of the table and sit next to that person who you like maybe didn't prefer to have to sit next to. For if that person is here, don't look at them right now, okay? But has this ever happened to you? You're trying to have a nice lunch and you hope to be able to have a conversation with that person, but they end up being like way over on the other side of the table, and the restaurant is noisy and the conversations are taking place, and it really doesn't matter how hard you try to listen, you just simply can't hear that person because they're seated too far away. Even if you haven't experienced this personally, you can imagine what it's like. You can even hear some of the noise of the restaurant behind you that's growing as you're trying to listen into that conversation and trying to participate. There's a sitcom that actually showed this same exact scene taking place where a group of guys went out to lunch together. And one of those guys was really frustrated because he didn't get to sit next to his best buddy. When he came to sit down, somebody else just hopped right in, and so he was going to go to the next seat, but somebody else was already there. And this was one of those restaurants where they cook the food right in front of you there, and so sometimes when you go to a restaurant like that, there are people who are strangers that get seated right where you are. And so not only did he not get to sit next to his buddy, but he was further away because of his friends, and then further away because of his strangers, way over on the other side of the table. And as the meal progresses, it's just hilarious. You can tell he misunderstands what's being said. He's calling out, like, guys, I can't hear you. I don't understand what you're talking about. Can you speak up? What was that? And he would say things, but it was very obvious the stuff that he said wasn't related to the conversation. And he just was increasingly more and more frustrated like this. Conversations that are like this, conversations that get interrupted, that have this conversation-killing distance in them, aren't limited to restaurants. So you've either been to a restaurant like this, or you can imagine a restaurant like this, or you might have even seen that scene from the sitcom that was like this, but it's not only in restaurants. It also happens at home, right? Between husband and wife, where, I mean, you're in the same house, but you're not really talking like you did before. And maybe there's this distance that's come between you, and it's almost like you're roommates. You live in the same place, but you're not as close as what you once were in the past. Or it can happen at work. I've heard several of you actually talk about how this kind of conversation-killing distance takes place between the boss, the management, and the workers. It would be great in your work environment. It would be so much better if the people who are in management would be able to clearly communicate with the people who are doing the work down on the floor, the people who are the staff. But there's this distance that's between the leadership, the management, or the workers and the staff, and it kills conversation. It happens in marriage, it happens in the home, it happens in restaurants, and I would say, worst of all, it happens with God. You see, because he's the one that we really need to hear from the most. I ought to be listening to my wife, right, honey? Yes, I ought to be listening to my wife. And I need to listen to my kids, and I need to listen to my coworkers and my boss, and I need to listen to my neighbors, and I need to have the ability to hear them, and those conversations get separated and drowned out by other noise. But God's the one that I absolutely have to be connected with. I'm looking for an answer, and I ask him this question, but I can't quite hear him. He's seated too far away at the table. And I need some direction in my life. I'm trying to make a decision about whether I should do this, whether I should take the job, whether I should make a change in my life. And I'm looking for direction and confirmation from God. But I can't quite hear him because there's something or someone in between God and I at the restaurant that I call my life. And I really need to hear from God, but yet sometimes I can't. The conversation is killed, it's drowned out by all that distance there. We've been talking a lot about what it is to be able to hear from God. And we know that God speaks. I mean, we can see examples of this throughout the Bible. We've shared with each other and we've raised our hands about, oh yeah, I heard God say this, or I received God's direction at this time in my life. And so we know he speaks, but we've also admitted sometimes we just can't hear him. All that background noise is drowning him out. And it's almost like there's something that's in between us and God when we're trying to listen. I mean, we wish we could hear him. We want to be able to hear him. But can we make God talk? No, he's not a puppet. We can't make God talk. We can't force him to speak. But we can make ourselves better listeners. And that's a lot of what I'm trying to help direct our attention towards as we've been talking about this sermon series, Signal Boost. How is it that we can sit closer to God at the table? How is it that I can make sure that this background noise is lowered down? How is it that I can ensure that nobody wedges their way in between God and I, or that nothing, no thing, no action, no activity, no habit, no addiction makes its way so that it's in between God and me when we're at the table? Because I need to be able to hear from him. That's what I want us to be able to talk about here. Can you remember a time in your life in the past where you felt closer to God than you do now? Think about your life and your experience. Where you are now, and reflect on, was there a time in my life where I felt closer to God than I do today? Does anybody feel like that? I see a few hands. I see more hands, a bunch of hands if we're honest with it. Okay? And reflect on what that was like for you, knowing that that's a part of your spirit inside saying, it sure would be nice if I could scoot closer to him at the table. Now, if you've never felt close with God, because that's true for some of us as well, if you've never felt like, oh man, yeah, I can really hear him, I'm really close to him, I'm very passionate about him, I'm into his word every day, I love getting together with his people, I'm a part of the things that are going on in the church, I participate in the actions that God is participating in my workplace and in my community, in my home, and I feel really close with God, but for some of us, we've never had that, ever. And if that's who you are, if you fall into that category, then you're going to want to head over to Facebook and listen to the sermon that was from 3 weeks ago, because we talked about that just 3 weeks back. But for those who are already a part of his kingdom, have you felt closer to him in the past than what you do today? Maybe at some point in the past, you were more passionate about his word, and you were just excited every time that you got it out, and it was like he was speaking directly to you. And you'd flip the page, and it was talking about something that just connected right with your situation. And you'd be spending time in prayer and just loving what you would be able to say and hear from God, and spending more time with God's people. You had this passion. You had this alignment with his priorities. But over time, for many of us, something changed. What was that? I mean, is it just inevitable? Is it impossible to stay close to God? I hope that you don't believe that. I hope that we can figure out what that thing is, because it's a lot like that noisy restaurant. Something gets in the way between us and God. I mean, he's still here, and it just gets harder and harder for us to be able to hear him. And I think the sad truth about this is it happens to all of us. So even if you didn't put your hand up, even if you're not like, oh yeah, I remember a time in my past where I used to be closer to God, it happens to all of us at some point in our lives. Sin is anything that separates us from God. That's the definition that I use most often when I talk about sin. And it's probably not all that surprising to hear a pastor in a church building talk about sin, but I think it's a lot more common for us to use lists of rules, things that we must do or things that we must not do when we're talking about, so what is sin? What is it that I'm not allowed to do? And we have these lists of sins, make sure that you don't do this, make sure that you don't do that, and these lists of commands so that we have to follow those rules and obey those commands, and if we don't do them, then that's wrong, and so we would call that sin, and that could be helpful. It could be helpful for us to figure out what's right and what's wrong. But you know just as well as I do, we get pretty creative when it comes to bending the rules, right? I mean, come on, be honest. I can find a way to technically do the thing that I'm supposed to do, the thing that I was told to do. I did what was said, or I did what was written, but I didn't really. Because I bend the... Am I the only one? Right? Come on, we bend the rules. And so we have these rules, and God says, do this and don't do that. But when we look at the word sin, and we see it as it's anything that separates us from God, that list of rules really is not the definition that I'm going to use anymore. Because if I'm technically doing the thing he asked, but I'm really not, I'm separated from God. I mean, if I'm on the outside following all the right procedures, but in my heart I'm cut off, then I'm separated from God. If it's a way for me to, I didn't really lie. I spoke words that were true, but when I spoke them, I led someone to believe something that wasn't true. And so we'd be like, well, I didn't lie. But you're separated from God. This is what sin does to us. It wedges its way in at the table and sits itself right down, and then it brings its buddies and they sit right down, and we end up way, way cut off and not able to hear from him. Isaiah 59:2 tells us the same thing in God's word. It says these words here: your iniquities, that's a type of a sin, your iniquities have separated you from God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. That last part stings a little bit, doesn't it? It hides his face from us. I mean, I want to be able to see him. I want to be able to perceive him. I want to be able to hear him. I need to know what it is that he says. I need an answer for my question. I need direction for this decision that I'm making. I need God's communication in my life, but I'm cut off. I'm separated. By what? By sin. And that's what sin does to every single one of us. One of the great tricks, one of the great tools that our spiritual enemy uses is to convince us that we're not separated from God. To convince us, everything's fine. And so the devil will come and present this idea to you and to me and make you think, oh, yeah, I could do this. I'm all right. We could just keep right on going. We can maintain the way that things are going. All the while, we're getting further and further and further separated from him because more and more and more and more sin is sitting down at the table and pushing us further away from God. Sin blocks our communication with God. Sin, it says sin hides his face from us. Like those people who sit down between you and your friend at that noisy restaurant. Sin gets in the way. And that separation from God that's caused by our sins is something that you and I can read about throughout the Bible, not just one line from Isaiah 59. It's all over the place, in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, throughout the books here. God gave Moses instructions about how to build a place of worship so that people would be able to come near to God. So he said, hey, Moses, this is the way that I want for you to construct this and to arrange this and to get people to run this so that there would be this place where people could draw near to God, this place of worship. And in that place of worship, God told Moses, I want you to make a special room. You know, there's going to be like different areas and put this thing over here and put that stuff over there and here's the furniture. Gave him all the details, but this one spot was unlike any other. It was unlike any other part of that place of worship, and it was unlike any other place in the entire planet. It was set apart from all of the rest. It was holy. It was sacred. In fact, sometimes we call it the Holy of Holies, or the most holy place. If you have your Bible, or if you can borrow a pew Bible, go ahead and turn to Hebrews 3. We're going to look there in just a moment together here. And we're talking about when the Jews would come together in this place of worship, this place that God had asked Moses, here's how I want you to put it together. And, I mean, when they would come to worship, they couldn't just waltz right in to that special holy place. They didn't have the right, they didn't have the authority, they didn't have the freedom. Their sin separated them from God, just like your sin and my sin separates us from God. In fact, that's how we all start in life. All of us has this nature in us to sin. It is natural for us. We are drawn to sin. It is much more natural for us to sin than it is for us to not sin. And you know this because look at our world, right? Not with a pointing finger of condemnation, but to say, God, we need you to do something about this. I need you to do something about this in my life. I just feel drawn to sin, and I feel cut off from God because my sin separates me from God. That's what we're going to look a little bit at here in this text in Hebrews 3. This is why Jesus made a way for us. You see, the same way that God established systems and procedures for the Jewish people in the Old Testament, Jesus made a way, not just for the Jewish people, but for all of the people in all of the world, and that includes you and me, so that we wouldn't have to be separated from God. We all have sin. We all get separated from God. But Jesus made a way for us to be reconnected with him. And he gives us these gifts. He gives us forgiveness. He gives us mercy and grace. He gives us the gift of heaven and eternal life. He gives us the gift of salvation. And I'm deeply thankful for these gifts. Many of us already have received these gifts, and we celebrate these gifts from God. But even though we've got those things, we've received those gifts from God, our forgiveness, our salvation, eternal life, even though we have these gifts, we still find ourselves seated at the table further and further away to the place where I'm really struggling to hear from you, God. Like, you know, I heard from him once. Maybe it was like a really great preacher long ago, or maybe it was this time where somehow, I don't know, but I was in my Bible and it just seemed like it was speaking to me, but here I am further and further away from God. Maybe that's how some of us are feeling here today. The more sin that we have, the further we end up from him. I don't want you to raise your hand, because I'm not looking to embarrass or point anybody out in this moment, but I want you to think, for those who have already received those gifts, for those who are already saved, have you sinned since the time when you were saved? Oh. I mean, since the time when you accepted Jesus as your Savior, when you received that gift of eternal life, has any sin taken place in your life? That's how we get separated from God. That's what sits down at the table and pushes us further and further away. That's why it's harder and harder for us to hear him. You've had plenty of time to flip pages. Let's go ahead and look at Hebrews 3 together. I should have turned there too. Here we go. I'm going to start at the beginning of the chapter. Hebrews 3, it says this. Therefore, holy brothers and sisters who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on Jesus, whom we acknowledge as our apostle and high priest. And when it calls Jesus our high priest, it's talking about the one whose job it is to connect the people with God. That's what Jesus did for us. Verse 2, he was faithful to the one who appointed him, just as Moses was faithful in all God's house. Jesus has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses. Moses was good. Moses was helpful. He was a leader. He didn't do everything perfectly, but he did lead people. And it says, just as the builder of a house is greater, has greater honor than the house itself. Look at verse 4. For every house is built by someone, but God is the builder of everything. Moses was faithful as a servant in all God's house, bearing witness to what would be spoken by God in the future. But Christ is faithful as the son over God's house, and we are his house. So what are we talking about now? We're talking about the church, okay? And you've probably heard it said before. You may have, but the truth is the church is not a building. We'll talk about the building as if it is a church, but that's not the way that God used that word. We are the church, and it says we are God's house. Reading a little bit further still in verse 6, it says, if indeed we hold firmly to our confidence and the hope in which we glory. Now, for the next part there, like it starts in verse 7, how many of your Bibles are laid out just a little bit differently in that next section right there? Maybe it's like indented, I see you nodding your heads. Is it laid out differently for some? Okay, so like at least half of us in the room, when you look at your Bible, that next part visually looks somehow different from the other parts. Not every Bible is like that because they're not all printed exactly the same. But the reason why many of our Bibles have this next part indented or somehow different from the others is because it's a quote. The next part that we're going to read here in Hebrews 3 is a quote that comes from somewhere else. And so I want to make sure that we can see this and understand, oh yeah, we're reading it in Hebrews 3, but it's not only in Hebrews 3. It also shows up in other places. So look at it with me starting in verse 7. So as the Holy Spirit says, today if you hear his voice, ooh, there we go. You can see why I wanted to talk to you about this, right? Because we're trying to hear God's voice. It says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the wilderness where your ancestors tested and tried me. That's the Lord. though for 40 years they saw what I did. That's why I was angry with that generation. I said, their hearts are always going astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared an oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. Verse 12, see to it, brothers and sisters. So here's instruction. Based upon this quote, see to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God, but encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today. Is it still called today? Yeah, okay, it's still called today. So that none of you may be what? Yeah. So that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. So these lines right here in verses 7 through 11, that indented part for many of us, that's a quote that came from Psalm 95. So if you don't need to, but if you were to go back and look at Psalm 95, you'd find the same thing there. You'd also find some other stuff, because it doesn't quote the entire chapter. But there in Psalm 95, it mentions these two locations, Massah and Meribah. And it was the place where this rebellion took place. So it's saying, hey, don't do what they did in the rebellion. Don't act the way that they did, because when they did that, their hearts got hard. If you can hear God, make sure that you don't let your heart get hard. Make sure that you don't do the things that they did back at Massah and Meribah. This problem that had taken place that Psalm 95 talks about here is actually referring back to Exodus 17. So it's like this train car where one links to the next, links to the next. And you can see displayed on the screen, Hebrews 3, where we started, is looking back at Psalm 95. And Psalm 95, that mentions the location, Massah and Meribah, is looking back at Exodus 17. And so once again, I'm not suggesting you got to flip there. But if you want some more information, you could certainly read that later. These Jews in Exodus 17 were on their way to the Promised Land. So the big idea for Exodus was they cried out to God as slaves in Egypt, help get us out of here. And God sent Moses. Moses goes to Pharaoh and says, let my people go. Remember that? Okay, and then the 10 plagues, rough day. And then finally Pharaoh's like, get out. And so they leave, but they haven't yet gotten to the Promised Land. They're in between Egypt and the Promised Land. They're on the way there. And here we are in chapter 17 that something takes place here. They're in a desert. And it's one of those days where if you're in the shade, it might get down to 110. And their throat is just parched. And they're sweaty. And deodorant has run out long ago. And we still got to walk. We still got to go. We didn't get to the Promised Land yet. And so what do? They did the same thing that you and I would have done. They start complaining. I can't stand this. You know, at least back when we were in Egypt, we had provisions. We had access to water. We had access to food. They're kind of forgetting the fact that they were slaves who were abused and beaten and mistreated, and they have no freedom and no rights and no opportunity and no choice. But like, man, at least we had, remember back when we had water? Yeah, we'd go get water from that one well. And they're complaining. And they're complaining to each other. They're complaining to their leader, Moses. They're complaining to God. And so God speaks to Moses and he says, I want you to have a conversation with that rock over there. That's kind of weird. They're thirsty. It's hot. It's dry. They're whining. They're complaining. They're fussy. And God says, Moses, the solution to this is I want you to have a conversation with that rock over there. And think about how the emotions and the tiredness and the spent patience all contribute to the situation. I mean, this has probably happened to you. I don't think it's only happened to me before, but if I've spent all my patience in one area, then when something else comes up that I would normally be able to take care of, and something else annoys me or frustrates me or inconveniences me, and by itself, it's not really that big of a deal, but because I have used up all of my patience on this and this and this and this, then when this little thing happens, what do? Am I the only one? Okay? And overreact, you're like, no, you're not alone. I just don't want to admit it out loud, okay? I get it. I understand. This is life here. And so these people were cranky, and Moses was cranky, and he's like, I don't get how talking to a rock is going to solve this problem. So instead of speaking to the rock, the Bible tells us in Exodus 17 that Moses yells at the people. Ooh. That's not what God asked him to do, right? And he's yelling at the people, and he takes his staff, and then he starts hitting the rock. Bam, 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 like that one time when mom lost it in the car because the kids were in the back, and they were going bonkers, and dad slams on the brake, and he's like, if I have to turn this car around, and everybody's going crazy, and we really try not to talk about it, right? Okay? Moses is doing this to the rock. Bam, bam, bam. And water came forth from the rock. God had provided to them, even though they're all misbehaving, they're all doing exactly what they shouldn't be doing, and we know it, and they probably knew it too. But when it happened, God called them out on all their complaining. God called them out on their disobedience. It was not appropriate, it was not okay, it was not acceptable for them to be sinning in that way. That little story, that account, took place at Massah and Meribah. That's where this was happening. And when that happened, it became so famously known that, yeah, you guys remember when we all lost it, and then Moses starts beating the snot out of the rock, and then the water came, and do you remember that? Yeah, because they didn't just write about it in Exodus 17, they also wrote about it in Psalm 95. And it tells us that when they did that, their hearts became hard, like the rock. Like that rock that you can't just go up to a rock and say, hey, rock, I'm thirsty, and then like hold out your cup. It doesn't work that way unless God is involved. And they were hardened in their hearts. Why? God's word tells us it was because of their sin. That's the account that we're thinking about here. When we read in Hebrews 3, it's looking back to Psalm 95. It's looking back to Exodus 17. And in Hebrews 3, it tells us, if you hear his voice, and many of us have heard that call from God that says, come into my family, come into my kingdom, let me give you this gift of eternal life, let me give you this gift of freedom. Many of us have heard that. If you hear his voice, it says in Hebrews 3, do not harden your hearts as you did in that rebellion. So the people who were the original recipients of this letter that we call Hebrews, they weren't around when Moses was in the desert with those Jews. So what's the big deal here? Like, well, as you did in the rebellion, we weren't even there. Well, yeah, but we're a part of the same people group called humanity, okay? This is the human condition, and this is why we don't hear from God when sin sits down at the table in between us and God. If you want to hear from God in your life, if you need an answer to that burning question inside, if you are looking for direction about a decision you were making now or in the near future, if you have something that lies before you but you don't even know which option to choose from, I can't decide, I have no options, or all the options that you have stink, or you're facing a problem that you can't fix and the person next to you can't fix, you've got a bill that's bigger than the bank account, you've got a diagnosis, or your loved one has a diagnosis that doesn't have a procedure or a surgery or a medicine. When you have zero good options, we desperately need to hear from God. If you need to hear from God, when you want to hear from God, when you're hopeful, that you just, you know what, I want to be close to God like what I was in that one part of my life, I wish that I could get like that again. If you fall into this category here, get rid of the sin in your life. It's at the table with you, but it wasn't invited to sit down there. It should not be on the bill. It should not be getting refills of its drink when the server comes by. Get rid of the sin. Like the bouncer in the picture who's chucking that guy out of the restaurant right there. Sin is anything that separates us from God. God is the only creator of life. If you or I get separated from the only source of life, that means we have death. Get rid of sin because it's killing you. If I'm telling lies, then do you die? Probably not. Do I die? Probably not. So we're speaking metaphorically here. What is it that dies if I'm telling lies? Go on, say it. What dies if I'm telling lies?
Your relationship with
Yeah, my relationship with God and my relationship with you, if I'm lying to you. Do you still trust me, James, if every time you talk to me, lies are spewing out of my mouth? Yeah, yeah. You find out that they're lies, then that trust dies. Our friendship dies. My relationship with God, man, it wedged itself right there at the table, and it didn't belong. What if I cheat on my spouse? If I'm unfaithful to my spouse, we call that sin. What is it that dies? Do I die? Maybe if my spouse kills me. But what is it that dies if I cheat on my spouse? Our marriage, our intimacy, our friendship. Can you see? If I take something that doesn't belong to me, my reputation dies, my freedom dies because I wind up in jail. It doesn't matter which one of the things on the list of rules that I break. It doesn't matter if it wasn't even listed in the rules. If I am separated from God, we call that sin, then I have death. That means your sin is killing you. That's not the way temptation looks when we look at it. When we look at temptation, it's like, oh, this is going to be fun. I want this. I want to do that. This sounds fantastic. Look, all these people are doing it. And they're enjoying it. I want to do it too. That's Satan's trick for you and for me, to disguise it, to make it look like it's attractive, to make it look like it's enjoyable. And at first it is, but really it's just death in disguise. It's killing you, and it's keeping you from being able to hear from God. Romans 8 tells us the same thing. It says in Romans 8 how the Holy Spirit raised Jesus from the dead. If you want to look at it with me, you can turn there in Romans 8. It talks about the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead also raised you and I to life when he comes and lives within us. So our sin makes us dead, but the Holy Spirit makes us alive. And then it says in Romans 8:13, if we keep sinning, we'll die. This is God's word to us in Romans 8:13. If we keep sinning, we will die. But if we put that sin to death, end it, stop it, break free from it, change. Change a relationship or end a relationship. Quit going back to that place where that sin happens. Change the habit, change your thinking, change the addiction. If we put it to death, if we kick it out of the restaurant, then it says, God says, we will live. That's Romans 8:13. So if we look together at Romans 8, starting in verse 14, it says this. Romans 8, starting in verse 14. Those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves. That's what sin does. Sin makes you a slave. But it says here in verse 15, the Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. We become sons or daughters in the family of God. How? Not because we've done anything good. Not because we tried to resist temptation or get free from sin. We should do that. We should resist temptation. We'd be free from sin. But that's not how we become a part of the family of God. It's because of the Spirit's work inside of you and inside of me that makes us adopted. And it says here still in verse 15, and by him we cry out, Abba. That's a word that means daddy, father. The Spirit himself testifies. That's a word we could fast forward right through, but we really shouldn't. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. What does it mean to testify in court? Yeah, you're exactly right, James. To talk about, you need to speak the truth. That's literally the definition of the word confess. Confess isn't only to admit you've done something wrong. It also means to admit something that you've done that is good. Confess means to tell the truth. So here, testify. If I'm in court and I give my testimony, if I testify in court, I'm talking about the crime that I observed. I testify. If I testify about my faith to somebody else, what does that mean? It means I speak about my faith in Jesus. It means I talk about my relationship with God. Here it says, the Spirit testifies. Same word. Testify in court. Testify to someone about my faith. The Spirit testifies to our spirit. You know what that means? He speaks to you and to me. He wants you to hear him. And he is speaking. Do you want to hear from God? We've been talking a lot about it. Is that something that you hope for? get your seat at the table, the right seat, the good seat, the seat that's right next to your buddy, your best buddy, Jesus, the one that you want to hear from, the one that you need to hear from. Make sure that's where you are seated at the table, and kick out from the restaurant, kick out from your life. Get rid of that sin that does not belong. It's time. You've been thinking about it for a while. You've been thinking, you know what? I really need to stop. You know what? I really need to change. You know what? I recognize, and I have for a long time, that this thing in my life, you've been thinking, this thing in my life just doesn't belong. It's time. It's time to repent from that. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves, but do what it says. Reflect on your heart. Jesus said that he will show himself to those who keep his commands. Do you want to be able to see him and hear him clearly? Get rid of the sin in your life. I asked you earlier to think back to a time in life where you felt closer to God. Think about it again. That moment, that closeness, that could be today. That could be right now. You don't have to be on the other end of the table. You don't have to be outside the restaurant hoping to get a table. You can be all the way face to face with the God of the universe, with nothing in between you and him today, right now. Let's pray together. God, for us, sin takes a variety of different shapes, some that are quite obvious and embarrassing, and some that are quite subtle and masked. But one way or the other, we know that it separates us from you. So, Father, I want to just give time for your church, the people who are here, the people who are watching the video, to give time that we might pray to you in confession and repentance. We pray to you now, God. Some of us need to do business with God. He made a reservation. We need to show up and sit down with him. And so if that's you, you can do that right here. You don't have to walk out just because we're done and everybody else leaves. If you want to, stick around. Spend some time praying. Be with God if you would like to do that now. May we be closer and closer to the Lord of the universe. May we throw out sin from our lives and get rid of everything that entangles us. May we be able to hear from him his call to new life, to new hope, to new freedom. May we be his.